Accounting 12 Conceptual Framework and Accounting Standards. PAS 38 Intangible Assets, Final Lecture 2. Learning Objectives. The students should be able to discuss the objectives and scope of PAS 38, explain the recognition principle of intangibles, define the measurement of intangibles, specify the disclosure requirements of intangibles. Let us first know the nature of intangible assets. Intangible asset is an identifiable non-monetary asset without physical substance. Ibig sabihin, pagmamay-ari mo pero hindi mo nakikita. Critical attributes of an intangible asset. Based on the definition set by the standard PAS 38, the critical attributes of an intangible asset: first, it must be identifiable. In order to be recognized as intangible asset, it must be identifiable. Ibig sabihin, kaya mo identify separately from the other assets. Next, control. The power to obtain benefits from the asset. So, hindi pwede na i-recognize mo yan as intangible asset, pero wala kang control sa asset na yan. Okay? So, ano nga ba yung intangible asset? From the word intangible, kasi sabi nga, pag tangible, nakikita mo, nahahawakan mo. Yung intangible, hindi mo nahahawakan. Pero, pagmamayari mo. Later, magbibigay tayo ng mga examples ng intangible asset or those asset with an identifiable non-monetary asset, meaning hindi naman natin nakokolektaan like financial asset. Merong certain amount that is collectible like receivables or loans receivable, monetary asset without physical substance. Ibig sabihin, hindi nahahawakan, hindi nakikita. Pwedeng merong symbol or merong representation mismo ng intangible asset pero hindi mismo yun yung asset. Okay? So, future economic benefits such as revenues or reduced future cost. So, we can say that is an intangible asset kung merong future economic benefits from that intangible asset. Ano yung benefits na yun? Pwedeng additional revenue or reduced cost para sa entity. Okay, tandaan to. ICF, identifiability, control, and future economic benefits. Let's discuss further the concept of identifiability. This is the first critical attribute in order for intangible asset to be recognized in the financial statements of an entity. So we can say that an intangible asset is identifiable when it, first, is separable, meaning it is capable of being separated and sold, transferred, licensed, rented, or exchanged either individually or as a part of a package, meaning meron siyang sariling cost. Okay, merong amount mismo si intangible asset. Kaya siyang i-recognize separate from the other assets. Okay, so it would permit the recognition of intangible asset. Kasi ito intangible asset, one-line item in the statement of financial position. So, first, it must be separable. Kasi merong, kung asset yan, intangible asset yan, pero hindi mo naman pala pwedeng ibenta ng siya lang. Or kaya, pwede mo lang siyang mabenta pag ibebenta yung entity. Then, that is not identifiable. Hindi siya ma-identify mismo. Separate from the entity. So, kailangan separable siya mismo from the entity. Let's see. Patent. Capable ba siya of being separated and sold, transferred, licensed, rented, or exchanged? If yes, then that patent should be recognized as intangible asset. Let's say franchise. Example yan ng intangible asset. Bakit mo nasabi na example ng intangible asset? Meron bang physical substance? Nakikita mo ba yung franchise? Wala. Meron ka lang nakikita na document na nagpapatunay na merong franchisee, franchisor, pero yung franchise, yung right talaga, wala. Pero alam mong may asset ka, alam mong may right ka. Okay. Since meron kang right dun, and then it is separable, pwede mo siyang mabenta, pwede mo siyang matransfer, license, okay, can be rented, yung right mismo. Then, that is separable. So, any asset without physical substance, that is intangible asset. However, ang question, pwede ba yung ma-recognize sa financial statements? Paano malaman pag pwede siyang ma-recognize sa financial statements? Dapat, identifiable siya. Paano malaman kung identifiable siya? First, it must be separable. Or, it arises from contractual or other legal rights, regardless kung transferable yan or separable from the entity or from other rights and obligation. So, regardless kung separable siya or transferable, basta nag-arises sa contractual or other legal rights, then that is identifiable. So, ano yung mga legal rights? So, ang dami. Meron tayong copyright, yung mga author ng libro, hindi naman nila nakikita yung right nila, di ba? That is intangible asset. Pero alam nila na meron silang right dun sa piece nila, dun sa libro na ginawa nila. Since sila yung author talaga niyan. So, hindi yan pwedeng kopyahin. Hindi yan pwedeng i-plagiarize ng iba. And their right, that copyright sa libro na yan, it arises from legal rights. Merong legal rights sila dyan. Since hindi naman ibig sabihin na pag meron kang libro na nagawa, agad-agad meron na copyright si author. No. Kasi dadaan pa yan sa legal process. So, if it arises from contractual or other legal rights, then that is identifiable. Kaya yung copyright, nire-recognize talaga siya as intangible asset. Kasi nga, hindi lahat ng intangible asset, hindi lahat ng right na entity, hindi lahat ng asset na hindi nakita na entity, pero kinoconsider niya na asset, is kailangan i-recognize sa financial statements. Those asset lang, that are identifiable. Let's discuss the types of intangible asset para mas maintindihan natin yung concept ng PAS 38. Ano nga ba itong intangible asset? Meron tayong marketing related, merong customer related, merong artistic related, contract related, technology related, and goodwill. Again, the definition of goodwill, it is an asset, a non-monetary asset, without physical substance. Meaning, hindi nakikita. Sa'yo nga, pero hindi mo nakikita. Alam mong pagmamayari mo kahit hindi mo nakikita. First, let's discuss marketing-related intangible assets. Marketing-related intangible assets are those assets primarily used in the marketing or promotion of products or services. So, for example, trademarks or trade names. Ginagamit to primarily to promote products or services. Ano yung trademarks or trade names? Example, etong Coca-Cola, di ba? Canon, Microsoft, Mercedes-Benz, di ba? So, yan yung trademarks ng mga company. Hindi ito mismo yung pangalan ng company. Yung trademarks nila, sa pag-promote nila ng product, services, ito yung ginagamit nila. Coca-Cola, ito yung ginagamit nila sa mga products nila. So, ibig sabihin, hindi pwede na yung ibang business, okay, gagawa din sila ng product, then ipapangalan nila dun, Coca-Cola. Hindi pwede. Okay? Kasi meron ng company na pagmamayari nila to, sa kanila yung Coca-Cola na trademark. So, that trademarks or trade names shall be classified as an asset of Coca-Cola Company. So, hindi yun pwedeng agawin ng iba. Since nakapangalan na yan sa company nila. Next, newspaper masthead. Daming newspaper ngayon. Sino yung newspaper masthead? Example, eto yung Masthead. Part 2 ng newspaper. Masthead, the main banner that shows the name of the paper. They are large and bold to catch people's attention. In this case, it also functions as a pogwrat. It shows the price and date. So, masthead, hindi pwede. Nagagawa yung, kumbaga, kailangan kasi to na isang newspaper. Okay? So, right nila to. And tangible asset ito. So, hindi pwede na, kumbaga, may kukuha ng credit na sa kanila to, sa kanila yung dasan na masthead kung nakapangalan na yan sa iba. So, newspaper masthead. It is an example of marketing-related intangible asset. Okay? Those assets primarily used in marketing or promoting products or services. This is the right. Right nila yan sa masthead nila mismo. So, for example, si Philippine Inquirer, Filipino Star ngayon, yun yung newspaper masthead. So, sa kanila yun. Nakapangalan mismo yun sa kanila. Next, internet domain names. Example nito, eto, di ba minsan may mga website yung mga businesses. www. Eto yung domain name. .extension. So, etong domain name, pwedeng nakaregister mismo yan sa company. So, for example, pangalan ng company, ABC Company. And then, yung domain name nyo, www.abccompany.com. So, yung internet domain names, yun yung ginagamit nyo in promoting or marketing your products or services. Then, this is your asset. Asset pa rin naman to ni entity mismo. Since sa kanila to, pagmamayari nila ito. Hindi pwedeng akuin to ng ibang company, amin to. Kung sa kanila to, kung nakaregister to, kung sila ang gumawa mismo ng internet, kumbaga, website or ng domain name nila. So, this is specific mismo sa isang company or sa isang entity. Nakikita ba to? Ma'am, nakita naman siya. Pero ang sinasabi kasi dito, yung domain name mismo, yung right nila mismo dito. Dito sa domain name. So, yung right nila, hindi naman nakikita. Pero alam nila na sa kanila mismo yung internet domain names na yan. Non-competition agreements. Ano naman tong non-competition agreements? Etong non-competition agreements, minsan kasi may agreement na nangyayari, lalo na kapag, for example, employee and entity. Meron silang agreement na for this certain period, hindi ka pwedeng mag-apply sa the same entity. For example, terminate yung employee. So, meron yan non-competition agreement na hindi ka pwedeng mag-involve sa ganitong business. Or hindi pwede na mag-apply ka sa ibang entity na in competition sa entity na yan. For example, si employee siya ni company A. E ngayon, umalis siya kay company A, nagkaroon ng non-competition agreement. Meaning, si employee ngayon, hindi siya pwedeng ma-involve sa business the same kung anong industry si company A. Bakit ganun? Bakit meron pa ng competition agreement? Dahil sa mga trade secrets. Lalo na pag, for example, food industry yun. Okay? So, pritong manok. Let's say, pritong manok and then meron silang sariling recipe. Alam yun ni employee. Alam niya lahat. And then, so ngayon, aalis siya. So, etong non-competition agreements kasi, nasabi itong intangible asset kasi, between the entity and the employee, pwedeng for a certain period, let's say 3 years, hindi ka pwedeng ma-involve sa the same business. Kasi magkakaroon ng competition nun. And ang advantage dun kay employee A, alam niya yung mga sekreto ni business, ni company A, nung previous niya na employer. So, pag sinabi natin non-competition agreement, hindi muna siya makikipag-kompetensya with that certain entity for a certain period of time. Pwede siyang magtrabaho with another industry or pwede siyang ma-involve in another kind of business, pero hindi the same with that certain entity nung previous niya na employer. Example lang yan. Kasi meron mga employees non-competition agreements. So, meron din minsan entity and entity. Yung company A, company B. Meron silang non-competition agreements but that for a certain period, wala munang competition na mangyayari between them. Okay, so this non-competition agreements is an example of marketing-related intangible assets. Next, customer-related. Occur as a result of interaction with outside parties. Examples, customer list, internally generated itong customer list. Siguro, sa part ni NTD, yung mga listahan niya ng customer, kumbaga suki, asset niya yun. Asset yung support ni entity. Iba pag may business tayo. Eto si Aling Nena, ito yung lagi bumibili sa akin. Kino-consider natin yun as asset natin. Kasi ang dami nitong binibili every time na bumibili ito sa akin. So, yung customer list, example niya ng intangible assets. Hindi ko sinabi na kailangan to i-recognize sa financial statements. Kasi nga, hindi laman lahat ng intangible assets pwedeng ma-recognize sa financial statements. Those intangible asset lang na identifiable or can be separable apart from the entity. Pwede mo mabenta apart from the entity. Pwede mo matransfer apart from the entity. Etong customer list, since internally generated to, it cannot be separated from the entity kasi. So, apart from the entity, kasi yung mga customer, babalik yan, dun mismo sa entity. So, it cannot be separated from the entity. It does not arise also from contract or other legal rights. Kasi nga, internally generated to. Reports to within the entity na ito yung mga customers natin for this year. Ito yung suki natin lagi. Yung customers list. But, still, sa part ni entity, sa point of view ni entity, asset nila. Kino-consider nila as asset. Pero syempre, hindi naman lahat ng kino-consider natin as asset pwedeng ma-recognize sa financial statements. Depende kung na-meet nila yung criteria na sinet ni standards. Next, both contractual and non-contractual customer relationship. So, as you can see, this occur as a result of interaction with the outside party. So, that contract or non-contractual customer relationship. Yung asset naman dito, yung relationship na na-build ni entity doon sa customer niya. Diba? Asset yung support ni entity since pag na-build niya yun, babalik at babalik yung customers na yan. So, intangible asset yun. Hindi nakikita, pero may halaga sa part ni entity. Ito yung mga yung mga bagay na mahalaga sa'yo pero hindi mo pwedeng ma-recognize. Artistic related intangible asset involve ownership rights to place, literary works, musical works, pictures, photographs, and video, and audiovisual material. These owner rights are protected by copyrights. Ito yung, for example, kinuha yan na picture ni Juan. Hindi yan pwedeng ni Pedro. Hindi yan pwedeng sabihin ni Pedro na, uy, ako kumuha niyan. Ito yung covered by the copyrights. Or for example, kinompose siya ni Gary Valenciano, din sasabihin nila ni Miss Lucia, ako nag-compose yan. So, hindi pwede. Alam ni Gary Valenciano na meron siyang right mismo dun sa musical works niya. So, this ownership rights, yung ownership rights, intangible asset yun, are protected by copyright. Sa mga libro, si Valix, si Nick Aduana, alam niyang meron siyang right sa libro niya. So, that kind of ownership rights are example of artistic-related intangible assets. Right ni entity. So, asset ni entity. Contract-related. Intangible asset represent the value of rights that arise from contractual arrangements. So, contract related nga. So, malamang merong contract. Examples, franchise and licensing agreements. Familiar na kayo sa franchise, di ba? Si Jollibee, nagpapa-franchise yan. Sino pa? Si Miguelitos. So, merong franchise. When we say franchising, it is a license to use a specific trademark or business format. Let's say, kumuha ka ng franchise kay Jollibee. Si Jollibee ngayon, ipapagamit niya sa'yo yung trademark niya. Yung Jollibee mismo na pangalan or business format. And at the same time, magbibigay siya na mga kailangan mo to start the same business sa kanya. Like Miguelitos, pag kumuha ka ng franchise dyan, minsan sa franchise kasi si franchisor, yung nag-grant ng franchise, sila yung magbibigay ng product, sila yung bibigay ng ingredients. Kumbaga, ikaw na franchisee, ikaw na kumuha lang ng franchise, meron ka lang right na gamitin yung business nila. So, nagbabayad ka sa franchisor. And at the same time, sa part mo naman, meron ka ng right. Okay, na gamitin yung trademark nila, yung gamitin yung product name nila, and ibenta mismo yung products nila. So, in franchise, there is a license to use a specific trademark or business format. Franchise is the license itself, not the physical outlet. So, since the license itself, yun mismo yung franchise, then this is an intangible asset. Hindi nakikita. Yung license mo ba nakikita? Hindi. So, pwede na meron lang document that represent that license, pero hindi mo talaga nakikita yung right. Pero alam mo, that you have, you are licensed, you have the right to operate. Franchisee is the one who agrees to operate under the terms of the agreement. Franchisor is the one who grants the license specifying operating terms. Next, construction permits. Yung mga gumagawa ng mga bahay, nagde-design, nagko-construct. Diba meron silang contract? The rights, sabi nga, the rights that arise from contractual arrangement. So, since meron silang construction permits, they have the right to construct in a certain area ng certain building or certain na structure. They have the right. And that right is hindi naman nakikita mismo ng mata. So, without physical substance. Broadcast rights. From the word broadcast. Ito yung mga rights to broadcast events. So, pag merong certain events, merong certain sports event, meron bang rights sila na i-broadcast yan? So, yun yung kailangan meron talagang contract na giving them right to broadcast that certain event. So, that are example of contract-related intangible assets. Service or supply contracts. So, supply contracts between the entity and the supplier. Service contracts. So, yung contracts mismo nila, alam mo na meron kang, alam mo to, yung asset or meron kang rights from the supplier na mag-demand ng ganitong materials, ganitong input, since meron kayong contract. Yung rights mo nag-arise out of contract. Kasi kung wala kayong contract, hindi mo naman ma-deniband yan kay certain supplier. Pero since merong contract, may sasabi mo, or meron tayong contract, so hindi ka pwedeng humindi. So, ganun. So, as long as meron kayong contract, let's say, for 2 years, magiging supplier siya na entity for the certain raw materials, then si supplier, he is obliged to supply that raw materials to the entity for that certain period of time. So, that is a right on the point of view of the corporation or the entity. So, these are rights that arise from contractual arrangements. Technology-related intangible assets relate to innovations or technological advances. From the word technology nga, related siya sa mga new inventions or sa technology mismo. For example, naka-invent ng mouse na wireless. So, sino ba naka-invent nito? May patent na ba to? So, yun yung first example natin. Example kasi first, patented technology. Pag naka-invent ka ng isang bagay and gusto mo, masasabi mo talaga na akin to, ako naka-invent nito. Kailangan ma-applyan niya ng patent. So, ito yung tinatawag na patented technology. Naka-patent siya mismo. For example, sa certain company. Si company, nag-research siya, nag-develop siya ng product. And then, sa kanya talaga yung product na yun. So, ibig sabihin, a-apply niya yun ng patent. For example, yung mga gumagawa ng cellphone, gumawa sila ng bagong version ngayon. So, yung certain products na yun, kailangan applyan nila yun ng patent. Para masabi nila, meron silang ownership right mismo dun sa technology na yun. Masasabi nila, hindi yun pwedeng agawin ng ibang entity since meron silang right dun. Since na-applyan na nila yun ng patent. So, patents describes an invention for which the inventor claims the exclusive right. The inventor claims the exclusive right. So, kung naika-invento siya ng computer na mas maliit pa, kasi dati ang lalaki ng mga computer. So, yung mga naka-invento ng computer mas maliit, sa ipapatent nila yan. Naka-invento ng laptop na lumilipad, ipapatent yan. Diba? Para masabi, nasa'yo talaga yung invention na yan. Kasi baka maagaw ngayon ng iba and bilhin ng iba, so, sa kanya mapupunta yung credit. Okay? So, naka-invento ng wireless na charger. Noong time na naka-invento ng power bank, sino ba naka-invento ng products na yan? So, yun yung tinatawag na patented technology. Yung patent mismo, hindi yung technology, hindi yung inventions. Kasi yung inventions, nakikita yun eh. Yung product mismo. Yung technology mismo, nakikita yun. With physical substance yun. Hindi yun yung intangible asset doon. Yung intangible asset doon, yung right mo sa invention na yun. Yung patent. So, invention is patentable if new. Ibig sabihin, new innovation, useful, not obvious, and pertains to patentable subject matter. Next, trade secrets. From the word secrets, sikreto lang ng kumpanya. Alam nyo ba yung recipe ng Jollibee? Sa manok nila. Trade secret yon ng Jollibee. Example, mga famous trade secrets. We have formula for Coca-Cola. So, hindi yun pwedeng gayahin ng iba. Trade secret. Secret mismo yun ng Coca-Cola Company. The big, mga special sauce. So, sila lang nakakaalam nun. KFC chicken recipe. Sa kanila lang yun. Secret nila yun. Trade secret nila. Ano nga ba? Anong sikreto nila? Bakit ang sarap ng chicken nila? So, asset yun mismo ni KFC. Okay? WD-40 formula. Formula sa mga cologne, formula sa mga food products nila. So, yung mga ganun, yun yung mga trade secrets. So, applicable lang siya sa certain entity. Hindi siya pwedeng gayahin ng iba. For example, kaya merong trade secrets. Kasi, for example, sasabihin ng isang company na, uy, nauna ako rito. Tapos sasabihin na isang company, hindi, ako naka-formulate ng recipe na to. So, sino nga yan yung paniniwalaan kung sino talaga sa kanila yung mamayari ng recipe? Okay, so depende. Depende yan. So, dapat, yung trade secret mismo is ownership yan. Or merong rights dan. Rights dyan, yung mismong nakadevelop ng secret na yan. So, that is still part of technology-related intangible assets. So, pag sinabing technology, it relates to innovations. Kasi innovations naman to, yung mga formula, yung mga recipe, or technological advances. Etong patent nga pala, usually good for ano lang to eh? Good for 20 years and non-renewable. Ibig sabihin, hindi mo pwede ma-renew yung patent. Bakit? Kasi ano, para dito kasing tarang iniiwasan na kumbaga hindi mag-advance yung technology. Kasi kung i-renew na i-renew yan, kumbaga hindi na, pwede kasi niya na, pwede lang kasi na applyan ng bagong patent kapag meron kang upgrade, merong advancement ulit dun sa product mo, pero hindi pwede na as is lang siya after 20 years, ganun pa din. So, hindi pwede. Para magpatuloy pa rin yung advancement ng technology. So, kaya yun, non-renewable pag in-applyan mo ng patent yung invention mo. So, after 20 years, kailangan mag-isip ka kung paano yan i-upgrade, paano yan babaguhin, paano yan i-modify. When to recognize intangible assets? PAS 38 requires an entity to recognize an intangible asset, whether purchased or self-created, at cost. The initial measurement is at cost. If and only if it is probable, so more than 50% probability, more than possible, more likely that the future economic benefits that are attributable to that asset will flow to the entity. And the cost of the asset can be measured reliably. Actually, these are the criteria na sinet ng conceptual framework. In order for an asset to be recognized, it must be probable and measurable. PAS 38 includes additional recognition criteria for internally generated intangible asset. From the previous slides, we have two general criteria for intangible assets, probable and measurable. But PAS 38 includes additional, aside from the two, meron pang another criteria only applicable for internally generated, meaning so part lang mismo ng entity, intangible asset. Diba kanina na-discuss natin, example ng internally generated, customer's list. Kasi internally generated lang yung listahan ng mga customer, yung mga suki mo. Pero asset mo yan. In order to be recognized in the financial statements, the probability of future economic benefits must be based on reasonable and supportable assumptions about conditions that will exist over the life of the asset. The probability recognition criterion is always considered to be satisfied for intangible assets that are acquired separately or in a business combination. Kasi agad-agad yung probability natin na criteria, check na yun kapag in-acquire yung intangible asset or kapag na-acquire siya in a business combination. Itong business combination, separate topic na to, IFRS 3 ito. Pero yung sinabi natin yung business combination, parang si company A binili si company B. So, meron right si company A kay company B. So, ano yung mga asset? For example, meron intangible asset si company B na-acquire ni company A. True business combination. Nung in-acquire niya si company B, na-acquire niya rin yung intangible asset ni company B. So, pag in-acquire yan, through business combination or in-acquire talaga separately, then the probability recognition criterion is always considered to be satisfied. Pero kapag internally generated intangible asset yan, the probability of future economic benefits must be based on reasonable and supportable assumptions about conditions that will exist over the life of the assets. Dapat ma-check talaga kung meron ba talagang future economic benefits. So, note na, pag sinabi natin acquired separately, dumaan talaga sa process para makuha yung asset. For example, yung copyright. So, dumaan talaga sa legal process. Yung franchise, di ba? Meron talaga yung process para makuha si franchise. In-acquired talaga yun. In order na si franchisee, magkaroon siya ng franchise, kailangan nyo muna kausapin si franchisor, magkaroon sila ng agreement. So, pag in-acquire yun separately or in a business combination, okay na na masatisfy yung dalawang criteria stated from the previous slide. And also, syempre, the criteria na pinag-usapan natin kanina, sa umpisa pa lang, yung tatlong criteria, ICF, na sinet out ni PAS 38. na first, it must be identifiable. Next, dapat merong control sa entity and merong future economic benefits. If recognition criteria not met, ano mangyayari? Hindi siya pwede ma-recognize as tangible assets. If an intangible item does not meet both the definition of and criteria for recognition as an intangible asset, PS 38 requires the expenditure on this item to be recognized as an expense within it is when it is incurred. So, for example, yung customer list. Pasok ba siya sa criteria? Actually, hindi. Kasi hindi siya identifiable. Hindi siya separable mismo from the entity. Hindi naman siya nag-arise sa contract kasi wala namang contract. Internally generated naman yung customer list. And at the same time, hindi siya separable sa entity. Kasi yung customer, bumabalik talaga to that certain entity. Dahil talaga, yan yung entity na yan, dyan ako babalik. So, hindi mo masi-separate yung customer list from that entity, from the entity itself. And at the same time, yung customer list kasi, hindi mo talaga siya mame-measure. Paano mo measure yung amount ng customer list? Yes, kino-consider yan as asset ng entity kasi ito yung mga suki mo, yung mga listahan ng suki mo. Pero paano ka magsiset ng amount? Paano ka mag-estimate ng amount dyan? Anong amount ng customer's list mo? The cost cannot be measured reliably. And at the same time, yung loyalty ng customer, kumbaga, hindi naman yan consistent. Pwedeng list yan ng customer mo ngayon, pero baka next year or for the next 5 years, baka ngayon, may another entity na nag-boom yung product nila, then lilipat yung mga customers. And hindi mo hawak yung loyalty ng customers. So, ganun. So, kaya yung customer list, example siya, ng intangible asset nga, pero should be recognized as an expense when it is incurred. Kasi hindi niya na-meet yung criteria. Reinstatement, PAS 38 also prohibits an entity from subsequently reinstating as an intangible asset at a later date an expenditure that was originally charged to expense. Hindi mo naman mabago. For example, yung tangible asset, hindi naman niya na-meet yung criteria, kaya in-expense mo. And the later date, na-meet niya, hindi pwede yun na yung amount na na-expense mo na, recognize mo as intangible asset kasi na-meet niya na. Hindi pwede ganun. So, balik tayo sa original. Kung originally, na-charge na siya to expense, wala ka nang pakialam dun. Pag na-charge na to expense, expense na talaga yan. So, subsequently, the entity cannot reinstate that as an intangible asset. The entity cannot recognize that anymore as an intangible asset. Initial recognition, research, and development cost. Etong research and development cost naman, ibang usapan naman to. Alam niyo yun, merong research and development department usually sa isang entity. Yung research and development, simple, sila yung naka-assign na to do further research for new innovations and to develop new products. Ganun. So, syempre, pag sinabi nating research, nandun yung nagre-research, kung ano ba yung pwedeng improve, ano ba yung new formula, ano ba yung new product. Ito yung sa research phase. And after the research phase, darating yung development phase. So, after, ito na yung final formula. Sa development, i-develop na yung formula na yun. Okay. For example, gusto mong magpatayo ng manukan. And dine-discover mo pa lang anong recipe gagamitin mo. So, nagre-research ka pa lang. Okay. Nag-do it yourself ka pa. So, tinry mo yung ganito, na pag merong ganitong ingredients. Okay, pangit ng lasa din. Try ka na naman ulit. So, hinahanap mo yung lasa. So, ang tama dyan, yung tawag dyan na phase is research phase. Nagre-research ka pa. So, on the move ka pa na ma-discover yung tamang timpla or tamang recipe. And pag nakuha mo na yung final taste, so, dun ka na sa development phase. Ano yung development phase? Sa start ka na luluto gamit yung final formula mo or final recipe mo. And then, start ka na magde-distribute ng first product mo. I-develop mo na yung first product mo. Dun ka na sa packaging and then yung sa final output mismo ng product mo. So, yan na yun, development phase. Meron ka na nakuha from the research phase. So, sa research phase, kasi para siyang trial and error. Nandito yung trial and error. Pwede ka pang magkamali. Okay. So, ganun. So, let's say sa vaccine. Diba, nagre-research yan. Ano yung vaccine? So, pwede silang magkamali. Ganun. Hanggang sa meron na silang final na na-discover. So, pwede na mag-proceed na sila sa development phase. Magkakaroon na ng mass na production ng vaccine na na-discover nila or na-formulate nila. So, ganun. So, ngayon, yung expenses na na-incurred nila during the research, ano yun? I-charge ba yun as expense? Okay. Yung expenses na na-incurred nila during the development phase, i-charge ba yun as expense? So, paano? Anong treatment? So, let's discuss. Charge all research cost to expense. Okay. Since ito, wala pang kasiguradihan yung phase na to. Trial and error pa nga. So, wala pang kasiguradihan. Hindi mo naman alam dyan saan yan yung final dyan. So, nagpo-formulate ka pa. Tinitingnan pa yan yung final products. So, gumagawa ka pa ng initial move to discover new formula or new advancement. You upgrade dun sa product mo. So, all the research costs must be charged to expense. Wala pang asset dito. Research is investigation that you undertake to acquire some information, knowledge, or understanding. Sa research phase kasi, para kang nag-feasibility study. Okay? Nagre-research ka talaga. Ano ba dapat? So, kaya sabi ko kanina, for example, sa food ka, baga dinediscover mo, ano ba dapat yung kailangan dito para ma-achieve ko yung ganitong taste? Ano ba dapat? And then, sa product naman, for example, meron kang gustong gawin na product or invento na product, yung entity. So, sa research phase, nagre-research sila ng additional information, nasa investigation stage sila. For example, you are evaluating different alternatives for your new software product. Sabi ko nga kanina, trial and error itong phase na to. Nato trial and error, wala pang kasiguruhan saan dito, anong alternative. So, tinatry mo lahat. You're evaluating different alternatives for your new software product. Or you are examining the competing products on the market, studying their features, and trying to find their weaknesses in order to design better product. Oh, minsan ginagamit to ng ibang company. Minsan bumibili sila ng product ng other company. And then, pinag-aaralan nila yung product ng certain company. Minsan, for example, yung mga gadget. Pinag-aaralan nila yun. Tinatry nila, ano bang meron sa product ng nakakompetensya natin. Okay? So, naghahanap sila ng weaknesses dun sa product ng other entities. And then, yun yung gagamitin nila para ma-improve yung product. Kumbaga, hahanap sila ng butas. Kasi kung for example, ito yung weakness. So, ito yung ilalabas natin sa market. Kumbaga, to design better product. Kasi kung hindi better yung product nila dun sa kalaban nila, then hindi yun magbo-boom sa market. Okay. So, etong phase na to actually, you are studying. You are investigating. The company is investigating. The company is trying different alternatives. Diba? So, yung cost na na-incur sa phase na ito should be charged to expense. You cannot capitalize any expenditure for research. This is an absolute rule. Yung research within the entity should always be charged to expense. You need to expense it in profit or loss as incurred. And let me warn you that yes, all feasibility studies evaluating whether the project is viable or not are research. Yung mga feasibility study for a certain business or for a certain products, that is part of research and need to be expensed in profit or loss. Now let's discuss the development phase. Development costs are capitalized only after technical and commercial feasibility of the asset for sale or use have been established. This means that the entity must intend and be able to complete the intangible asset and either use it or sell it and be able to demonstrate how the asset will generate future economic benefits. The rule is research costs should be charged to expense, but development costs may be capitalized. I'm not saying that development cost should be capitalized, but it may be capitalized. It may be recognized as an intangible asset only after technical and commercial feasibility of the asset for sale or use have been established. Kasi pwedeng after the research na development na, pero baka ngayon hindi pala tinanggap commercially. Hindi pala siya feasible. Hindi pala siya magbo-boom sa market. So, dapat na-set na yung commercial feasibility of that asset before that development cost can be capitalized. And, this means that the entity must intend and be able to complete the intangible asset and either use it or sell it. The entity itself has the intention to use the intangible asset or kung ano man yung na-formulate or na-discover during the development phase or yung na-develop mismo ng entity and be able to demonstrate how the asset will generate future economic benefits. Development usually happens after the research phase. At the development stage, you actually plan or design the new products, materials, processes, or etc. before the start of commercial production or use. So, after the research phase, alam mo na kung paano magsisimula. Nalaman mo na yung formula. So, sa development stage kasi, dine-develop mo yun nasa research. You actually plan na or design for that new product. Before the start, development phase that is before the start of commercial production. Meaning, na before siya i-distribute sa market, before siya makakita ng customers, so, that is the development phase. Okay. So, before pa, it is critical to distinguish development and research. Bakit critical itong part na to? Kasi nga, magkaiba sila ng treatment. So, kailangan ma-distinguish na entity. Anong part yung research? Anong part yung development? Because research, treated as expense. But, the development cost can be capitalized. So, we can capitalize the expenditures for the development. We can. It's not required, but we can capitalize the expenditure for the development once na ma-meet yung criteria. You have to meet 6 criteria before you can capitalize these expenditures. So, these are the 6 criteria. Asset in PAS 38. So, this picture, this is from cpdbox.com. Pero nasa PAS 38 ito. The condition for capitalizing development cost, pirate, mnemonics, na ginawa ng cpdbox.com. So, pwede kayong gumawa ng mnemonics ng sarili nyo, pero pwede na rin itong gamitin, pirate. Ito yung 6 criteria in order na yung development cost makapitalize as an intangible asset. First, probable future economic benefits. Intention to complete and use or sell it. Kasi baka mamaya dinevelop yan. Pero wala naman palang intention si management or si entity na i-distribute siya commercially. Resources adequate and available. Mamaya, may intention lang pala si management pero wala pala silang budget. So, dapat available yung resources. Next, ability to use or sell the asset. Technical feasibility. Ibig sabihin, alam na entity na pagkapag nilabas yun sa market, pag nalaman yun ng market, is magbo-boom yun. Meaning, mabibenta yun. Merong probable inflow. sa entity. Merong technical feasibility dun sa na-discover, dun sa invention, or dun sa na-develop ni entity. Expenditures reliably measurable. Kasi kung hindi mo ma-measure yan, anong i-recognize natin? So again, pi rate. P, probable future economic benefits. I, intention to complete and use or sell it. R, resources adequate and available. A, ability to use or sell the asset. T, technical feasibility. E, expenditures reliably measurable. Initial recognition, research and development cost. Note, if an entity cannot distinguish the research phase of an internal project to create an intangible asset from the development phase, kasi diba ito yung critical part, yung i-distinguish mo yung research sa development phase. Kasi nga, yung research expense, yung development, pwedeng makapitalize. So, critical tong area na to. Pero paano ngayon pag hindi ma-distinguish na entity? Ano yung research? Asan dito yung cost na pang research, yung cost na pang development? So, the entity will treat that expenditure for that project as if it were incurred in the research phase only. So, mahirapan si entity na mag-distinguish kung yung cost na yan is for research or for development. Iti-treat siya as research phase. So, charge to expense. Again, dapat ma-distinguish yung research and development kasi nga si research expense, si development, it may be capitalized. Ngayon, kung hindi ma-distinguish, then ang treatment dyan, research phase. So, expense. In-process research and development acquired. Ito naman, hindi mismo research and development ng entity. In-acquire lang ng entity. So, for example, si company A. Meron siyang research and development department or area within the entity. Yun yung pinag-usapan natin kanina. Pero paano kung si company A, in-acquire niya si company B, and si company B, merong research and development din. So, ang tawag dun, kasi nga, pag in-acquire ng isang company, yung another company, lahat ng assets and liabilities ni acquiree mapupunta kay acquirer. So, for example, si company B na in-acquire ni company A, meron siyang research and development. Pag in-acquire siya ni company A, yung research and development ni company B, kay company A na yan. So, ito yung tinatawag na research and development acquired in a business combination. Na-acquire niya kasi nga, merong business combination na nangyari. So, anong treatment dyan? A research and development project acquired in a business combination is recognized as an asset at cost even a component is a research. So, pag ganito, pag in-acquire lang, wala na tayong pakialam kung research yan or development. Yung sin-acquire natin yan. Kasi nga, di ba, pag-acquire. Then, identifiable siya. Apart from the entity. Hindi siya internally generated. May internally generated kasi yun yung mga another criteria pa. So, eto, since in-acquire na in a business combination, sa part ni company A, dun sa illustration natin, treated na yun as intangible asset ni company A. So, even if the component is research, hindi niya naman yan, hindi naman yan cost incurred kasi ni company A. Cost incurred yun ni company B. And then, ang in-acquire lang dun ni company A, yung natapos na. Yung research and development. Ano yung research and development dyan sa company B? So, nalaman na yun ni company A. Okay. Sa pag-acquire niya ng company B, na-acquire niya na yun. Yung research and development ni company B. So, included na yun. So, therefore, it can be now recognized as an asset, intangible asset of company A. Again, yung pinag-usapan natin kanina from the previous slide, it pertains to internal research and development. Subsequent expenditure in that project is accounted for as any other research and development cost. Ano yung sinasabi ko? Pag si entity, si company A na mismo yung nag-incurred, nag-research, nag-develop, doon na tayo, balik na tayo sa kanina, sa concept kanina. Pero yung time na in-acquire mo siya, syempre, capitalizable lahat yan. Wala kang pakialam kung research ba yan or development. Hindi ka naman mismo yung nag-research dyan. Hindi naman ikaw nag-develop yan. Yung company B naman, yung acquirer. Ay, yung acquiree. Okay, so, iti-treat mo yan as asset agad-agad. Pero after na acquisition, after the acquisition date, syempre, kung meron kang subsequent cost na na-incurred through the research phase or additional cost na in-incurred sa development phase nung na-acquire mo na research and development. Then, based na yun dun sa yung concept, applicable na yung concept na na-discuss natin kanina. Okay, so ano yung concept natin kanina? Pag research cost, expense. Pag development cost, it may be capitalized. Kailan? Pag na-meet yung anim na criteria. Pirate, P-I-R-A-T-E. So, expense, yung research, except to the extent that the expenditure satisfies the criteria and PAS 38 for recognizing such expenditure as an intangible asset. Ano yung criteria? Yun yung 6 criteria na naset from the previous slide. Initial recognition. Ibang concept na naman to. So, we are done with the research and development. Now, computer software. Yung computer software kasi, doon meron tayong nakikita sa computer. Pero kung nahahawakan, merong physical substance, wala, diba? So, ano treatment doon? Intangible asset ba to? So, now, let's discuss kung i-recognize ba siya as intangible assets. If purchased, then that should be capitalized as an intangible asset. Pag pinurchase mo yung computer software, then i-capitalize yan ni entity. So, example ng software, eto, Chrome, Adobe, Office 365. Pag in-acquire yan, syempre in-acquire, may bayad, di ba yung Office 365? Pwede yung i-capitalize ni entity. Okay. Ito yung software. May mga software kasi na binibili talaga. As examples of software, MS Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Spreadsheets, Library Management System. So, pag pinurchase yan entity, it should be capitalized as an intangible asset. If it is part of the operating system for hardware, so, included in the hardware cost. For example, yung computer. Siyempre, meron yung cost yung computer. Equipment yan ni entity. If yung software is integral siya mismo dun sa computer, then part siya dapat ng computer or ng hardware. Katulad nito, ng Windows. Diba? Windows 7, Windows 10. No, integral siya. Dun sa hardware mismo. Diba? Nandun na siya mismo sa hardware. Operating system for hardware. Since kailangan siya mismo ng hardware, it must be included in the cost of the hardware and should not be separately classified as an intangible asset. Hindi pwedeng ganun. So, pag purchase siya, capitalize. For example, nag-purchase ka ng mga antivirus, i-capitalize yun. Pero yung mga operating system for hardware, like eto, part siya mismo nung hardware. So, hindi siya intangible asset. Next, internally developed. Ikaw mismo, entity. Ikaw gumawa ng software. So, whether for use, para lang gamitin na entity, or gusto mo talagang ibenta, involved ka sa selling ng software si entity. Then, it must be charged to expense until technological feasibility. Ito yung mahirap kapag internally generated, internally developed yung intangible asset. Kasi ang daming criteria, ang daming concept. So, pag internally develop yung computer software, charge to expense until technological feasibility, probable future benefits, intent and ability to use or sell the software resources to complete the software and ability to measure the cost. Familiar ba ito? Okay. Ito actually yung 6 criteria. The probable, intent, ability to use and sell the software resources to complete and ability to measure technological feasibility. Okay. Part na 6 criteria. Now, unless masatisfy ito, it's charged to expense. So, para sa research and development, charge yan to expense. Unless na lang ma-meet yung 6 na criteria. Okay. Kapag internally developed. So, be careful kapag internally generated and internally developed yung intangible asset. Kasi additional criteria na sinet si PAS 38 for internally generated assets. amortization over useful life based on pattern of benefits. Straight line is the default. Ina-amortize. Kasi nga, meron lang certain period of time na pwedeng magamit yung software. Internally generated brands, masthead, titles, and list. Na-discuss ko na to partly kanina. Brands, masthead, publishing titles, customer list, and items similar in substance that are internally generated should not be recognized as asset. First, kasi hindi nila na-meet yung criteria. They are not separable from the entity. Since yung brands, nasa entity mismo yan. Yung mastheads, part talaga yun ng entity. Publishing titles, customer list. Yung customer list, internally, asset yan ng entity. Pero, it should not be recognized in the external reports of the entity. And items similar in substance that are internally generated should not be recognized as asset. The entity can claim na sa kanila yan, pero hindi siya pwedeng ma-recognize as intangible assets of the entity. Since hindi naman din sila nag-arise into contracts, and then hindi naman, wala namang, kumbaga, it cannot be identifiable. It cannot be sold, it cannot be rented, it cannot be licensed. So, it is not separable from the entity itself. So, therefore, hindi niya na-meet yung criteria na sinet ni PAS 38. So, hindi siya pwedeng ma-recognize as asset in the statement of financial position. IAS 38 or PAS 38 prohibits capitalizing these assets if created internally. But if this is acquired, then pwede siyang makapitalize. Because it's hard also, if not impossible, to measure their costs reliably. And this is also one of the criteria na sinet ni standard. Dapat yung cost measurable. Paano mo ma-measure yung brands? Anong measurement? Anong cost ng brands na entity? Ng masthead? Ng pangalan ng, for example, sa newspaper? Ng pangalan ng newspaper niya? Paano natin may estimate yun? Yung publishing title, yung customer list, lalo na yung customer list. Paano ka magsiset ng amount para dun sa customer list mo? So, it's hard. Or it's impossible to measure their cost reliably. Therefore, they cannot be recognized as assets. The following items must be charged to expense when incurred. Internally generated goodwill, from the words internally generated pa lang. So, alam na natin, expense agad. Startup pre-opening and pre-operating cost. Before the operation, yung lahat ng mga cost na na-incurred. Startup cost. Should not be capitalized but should be charged to expense when incurred. Training cost, advertising cost, advertising expense law, training cost, training expense, relocation cost. Measurement. Ang taas ng discussion ng recognition, no? So now, punta na tayo sa measurement. Alam natin that the initial measurement must be at cost. Na-discuss natin kanina kung pwede ba siyang ma-recognize muna as asset. Na-discuss na natin yung concept. Now, let's go to the measurement naman. The initial measurement initially measured at cost. But the subsequent measurement, merong dalawang model. The cost model and revaluation model. The same sa PAS 16. As defined sa PAS 16, the same lang yung cost model and revaluation model as discussed dito sa PAS 38. Cost model, after initial recognition, the benchmark treatment is that intangible assets should be carried at cost. The initial measurement ito, less any amortization. So, yung cost from the initial measurement, less any amortization. So, sa part ng PPE, ito yung depreciation. So, yung depreciation sa part ng intangible asset, yung term na ginagamit ni PAS 38, amortization. Kasi nga, meron ng certain period. Okay, yung term ni intangible asset. Kaya ina-amortize natin yung intangible asset. And impairment losses, if any. And then sa revaluation model naman, intangible asset may be carried at a revalued amount. Ibig sabihin, initially measured at cost, and then at the end of reporting period, nagko-conform tayo sa fair value. So, any changes sa fair value, nare-record natin yun, nare-recognize natin. Unlike sa cost model, wala tayong pakialam sa changes ng fair value. So, dito, after natin mag-conform sa fair value or sa dun sa revalued amount, yun na naman yung subject to amortization and impairment losses. Unlike dito, cost model, yung cost talaga yung subject sa amortization. Pero sa revaluation model, nagre-revalue tayo, nire-revalue natin yung cost, and then that adjusted carrying amount or the new carrying amount, the revalued amount, yan na yung subject for any subsequent amortization and impairment losses. Only if fair value can be determined by reference to an active market. Siyempre, kung sa time lang na ma-identify yung fair value. Kasi, pag revaluation model tayo, hindi siya mandatory. Hana, yearly talaga or annually talaga nagre-revalue. So, minsan, every 3 years, every 2 years, or every 5 years. Depende kung gaano ka-significant yung changes sa fair value sa market nung asset. Such active markets are expected to be uncommon for intangible asset. Kaya rarely lang din yung gumagamit ng revaluation model sa intangible assets. Kasi nga, rarely lang na magkaroon ng fair value yung intangible asset. Hindi naman kasi talaga siya yung binibenta yung intangible assets mismo. Usually, sa entity lang talaga siya. For example, pinapatent niya yung product niya. Okay, rarely ka lang makakita ng patent na yung patent mismo yung binibenta. Siyempre, yung binibenta dun, yung product na covered ng patent. So, such active markets are expected to be uncommon for intangible assets. Classification of intangible asset based on useful life. Intangible assets are classified as indefinite life and finite life. Based on useful life na classification. So, merong indefinite, finite. From the word indefinite, gan, alam na natin to. Kumbaga yung mga ano, hindi mo alam, hindi mo ma-estimate yung useful life. So, foreseeable future. Nag-assume tayo na sa intangible asset will last for a foreseeable future. Indefinite. Forever. Ang hirap i-measure ng forever, ah. So, pag indefinite life, actually, ang treatment natin ito, walang amortization. Kasi kung hindi natin ma-measure yung useful life niya, hindi natin ma-measure kung ano yung term ni intangible asset na pwede siyang magamit ni entity, then paano natin makocompute si amortization? Since dun tayo magbe-base ng amortization. So, pag indefinite life, no amortization. Pag finite life, for example, good for 10 years lang siya. So, may mga legal rights kasi na sineset mismo ng law. For example, patent. Sineset mismo ng law na 10 years lang yung 20 years lang yung patent and non-renewable. For example, trademark. Yung trademark naman, 10 years lang, pero renewable. After 10 years, pwedeng i-renew. Okay? So, yung copyright actually, ano yun eh, mako-consider din yun as indefinite. Kasi sinet ng law na yung useful life daw ng copyright is the life of the author and 50 years after his death. So, hindi mo naman alam kailan mamamatay si author. Okay, ayun. Hindi rin ina-amortize yung copyright. Since indefinite din yung life niya. Subsequent measurement, intangible assets are classified as indefinite life or finite life. Indefinite life, an intangible asset with an indefinite useful life should not be amortized, as explained from the previous slide. Finite life, the cost less residual value of an intangible asset with a finite useful life should be amortized. Since alam natin kung ano yung term or ano yung useful life ni asset, so pwede natin siyang ma-amortize. Unlike sa indefinite, hindi mo naman natin alam, hindi naman natin mami-measure yung walang hanggan. So, it should not be amortized. Both classifications should also be assessed for impairment in accordance with PAS 36. This is a separate standard for impairment losses. Subsequent expenditure, it should be recognized as an expense when it is incurred unless it is probable and measurable. Di ba ito yung criteria para ma-recognize probable and measurable? So, kapag yung subsequent expenditure, for example, na-recognize na siya as intangible asset, then meron pang cost na na-incur si entity, let's say, next year, naka-incur siya, and then na-recognize na siya as intangible asset ngayon, then meron na-incur na cost next year. Ano yung cost na yun? Related naman yung sa intangible asset. Okay, probable ba that this expenditure will enable the asset to generate future economic benefits in excess of its originally assessed standard of performance? Then, kung merely, i-maintain niya lang yung economic benefits na mapoprovide na intangible asset, wag na. Hindi siya pwedeng i-capitalize. Expense na lang. Kasi maintenance lang yun. Pero for example, merong additional benefits. Okay, so merong excess, in excess of its originally assessed standard, merong additional benefits because of that subsequent expenditure, then it should be capitalized. And if this expenditure can be measured and attributed to the asset reliably, kung related naman din siya sa asset. So let's say, for example, merong na-invent na technology si entity. Na-apply niyo ng patent. So, nag-recognize ng patent this year. Pagka next year, meron siyang in-upgrade mismo dun mismo sa technology na meron ng patent. So, merong changes. So, yun, in-apply niya din yun ng patent. That is related patent mismo dun sa original patent. So, if there is a probability though that expenditure will enable the asset to generate future economic benefits in excess of its originally assessed standard. Since hindi naman yun pang maintenance lang sa original patent, as additional taga yun sa original patent, then pwede yung ma-classify as an intangible asset. So pwede siyang i-add, pwede siyang i-capitalize dun sa patent na na-recognize na for this year. So again, subsequent expenditure, wala na tayong problema sa initial recognition, na mention na natin lahat ng concept sa previous na topics natin, di ba? Ngayon, pag meron namang previous expenditures, naka-incur ka pa rin ng cost, anong treatment doon? Expense. General rule, expense. Unless probable na meron siyang additional benefits, kumbaga, in excess of its originally, ito yung term kasi dito, in excess of its originally assessed standard of performance. Not merely maintaining the original intangible asset, pero meron talagang additional na benefits na maibibigay sa entity. Then, that should be capitalized. And, the expenditure can be measured and attributed to the asset reliably. Disclosures required. Disclose the following information for each class of intangible assets. Amortization methods, carrying amounts ng intangible assets, line items, reconciliation, useful life. Ano yung reconciliation? For example, intangible asset beginning of the year, 10,000. Then, end of the year, 50,000. So, bakit yung 10,000 naging 50,000 na lang? So, ano nangyari during the year? So, ano yung reconciliation? And the useful life also of those asset with finite life. So, kailangan i-disclose to sa financial position or in the notes to financial statements. This is the end of final lecture 2. Thank you and God bless.